So now let us start our Acts of the Apostles. Let's begin with our opening prayer in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful and kindle in them the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit and they shall be created, and you shall renew the face of the earth. O God, who by the light of the Holy Spirit did instruct the hearts of the faithful, grant that by the same Holy Spirit we may be truly wise and ever enjoy consolations through Christ our Lord. Amen. Saint Justin, pray for us. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. So we're continuing the Acts of the Apostles on the third missionary journey of Saint Paul. So currently, we saw how St. Paul was stopping at Miletus, okay, the city of Miletus, just underneath Ephesus' top left corner there. And while he was embarked there, he called the elders, or should I say priests, okay, pastors of Ephesus, because Paul kind of had a feeling that it would be very difficult for him to come back to that community. So he was saying his last farewell. And he was telling the elders or the pastors or priests in Ephesus how to conduct themselves, how to keep faithful to the teachings of Jesus Christ, and how to take care of the people of the community. And so now from today's Acts of the Apostles chapter 21, we will see him traveling from Miletus, passing through Cos, the Rhodes Island, embarking at Patara, and then going down, passing Cyprus, and he's going to land in Tyre. And then from Tyre, he's going to go to Ptolemais, and then Caesarea, Maritime, and then finally, he's going to arrive in Jerusalem. Okay, so this is the last part of his third missionary journey. So here we go, Acts chapter 21. When we had parted from them and set sail, we came by a straight course to Cos, and the next day to Rhodes, and from there to Patara. When we found the ship bound for Phoenicia, we went on board and set sail. We came in sight of Cyprus, and leaving it on our left, we sailed to Syria and landed at Tyre, because the ship was to unload its cargo there. We looked up the disciples and stayed there for 7 days. Through the Spirit, they told Paul not to go on to Jerusalem. When our days there were at ended, we left and proceeded on our journey, and all of them, with wives and children, escorted us outside the city. There we knelt down on the beach and prayed, and said farewell to one another. Then we went on board the ship, and they returned home. When we had finished the voyage from Tyre, we arrived at Ptolemais, and we greeted the believers and stayed with them for 1 day. The next day, we left and came to Caesarea, and we went into the house of Philip, the evangelist, one of the seven, and stayed with him. He had 4 unmarried daughters who had the gift of prophecy. While we were staying there for several days, a prophet named Agabus came down from Judea. He came to us and took Paul's belt, bound his own feet and hands with it, and said, "Thus says the Holy Spirit, this is the way the Jews in Jerusalem will bind the man who owns this belt and will hand him over to the Gentiles." When we heard this, we and the people there urged him not to go up to Jerusalem. Then Paul answered, "What are you doing, weeping and breaking my heart? For I am ready not only to be bound, but even to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus." Since he would not be persuaded, we remained silent except to say, "The Lord's will be done." After these days, we got ready and started to go up to Jerusalem. Some of the disciples from Caesarea also came along and brought us to the house of Mnason of Cyprus, an early disciple with whom we were to stay. So, as we have seen in the map, Paul is now traveling from Miletus down to Phoenicia. It lands in Tyre, and it's from Tyre that he spends some time with the disciples. So in the verse 4, we see how the Christians of Tyre were the fruits of the early evangelization that we saw in Acts 11:19. In Acts 11:19, we read, "Now those who were scattered because of the persecution that took place over Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch, and they spoke the word to no one except Jews." So after Stephen's martyrdom, there was persecution going on, of course, which was led by Saul, or Paul at that time, called Saul, right? So he was the one also, you know, doing this. So all the Christians were scattered, and they went far as Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch. And from then on, there were Christians in Tyre. "The Spirit gave them foreknowledge of the imprisonment and afflictions awaiting Paul in Jerusalem." So, yeah, sometimes the Spirit gives us foreknowledge. Maybe it was through dreams, or it could be interlocutions or visions. But we know that for sometimes, you know, God sometimes allows us to see in the future. Now, this gets all really kind of complicated because we usually say, oh, God knows ahead of time. But once again, to explain this more plainly, God knows what's going to happen in the future for us is future, because for God, there's no such thing as past, present, and future. See, God is outside of time, so he knows everything. He knows everything. But it's just in our perspective, he knows what is going to happen in the future. And also, just because God shows us something in the future, it does not mean necessarily that we have no choice. For example, as we'll see here too, though, is that Paul has been given many warnings from these disciples who saw the future, that he was going to go to Jerusalem and then become persecuted. But see, Paul still had a choice. He didn't say, Now that, you know, like, I'm going to go to Jerusalem and I'm going to be persecuted. Okay, that's my fate. Okay, well, too bad. I can't run away because that's God's will. I gotta do this. Actually, no, it's contrary. Like, Paul had his choice. If he wanted to, he could have run away. He could have run away. See, when God shows us the future, it doesn't mean that it's our destiny or it's predestined, right? But I think, why did God give Paul this foreknowledge? Why did he give him this, you know, signs and visions, either to him directly or through other people, of his, you know, persecution that awaits of him? It's also because God wants to prepare Paul, you know? It's same with Jesus. Jesus knew that he would be betrayed. He knew that he was going to suffer. He knew that he had to die on the cross. He knew all that. But did that mean that Jesus had no choice? No, he had no choice. And that's why Jesus struggled. You remember the Garden of Gethsemane? He was kneeling and praying and shedding tears, sweats of blood. You know, and remember what he prayed? He said, Father, If it's possible, can you let this, you know, chalice of suffering pass by? Can I just not go through this? You know, that was Jesus' struggle too. Now, if Jesus really believed that there was a fate and there was nothing that he could have done to avoid this, why would he even struggle and pray like that? No, Jesus knew himself that he had the choice. If he said, sorry, Dad, like, I changed my mind. I can't die on the cross. Sorry. He could have walked away because we all have a choice. So, like, we have to remember that this is our choice. We all have a choice all the time. And we have to make that decision. Of course, Jesus chose to accept that fate, that he had to be crucified and he had to die and suffer. Why? Because Jesus knew that's what the Jews wanted to do. Okay, that's what the Jews and Romans was going to do to him. See? And God was telling Jesus, I want you to go through that. Okay? Because going through that suffering and pain and death, you know, Jesus is going to show us, the people, how much he loves us. And through his suffering and through his sacrifice, he's going to gain us an eternal merit that is so precious and invaluable that's going to pay off all our debts, like our debts in terms of humanity, and is going to be able to pay off the penalty of eternal death so that we have a chance to attain eternal life and be saved. See, but once again, it's not automatic. Just because Jesus died on the cross and died for us does not mean that we go to heaven automatically, because we still have a choice. We either we accept Jesus' sacrifice and say, yes, Lord, I accept your sacrifice and I accept you as my savior and I will, you know, follow you so that I can be saved. Because we still have the choice to reject Jesus. So don't fall into this trap just because Jesus died on the cross and made a sacrifice for us that we're all automatically going to be saved. Because once again, the freedom of will, the freedom of choice is still there. It's still there. And we need to accept it. We need to cooperate. Same Paul. You know, he hears all these news about him being persecuted in Jerusalem. But what does he do? He chooses. He chooses and says, no, I am going to go. I'm going to accept, you know, my fate. If that is what the Jews want to do to me, I'll accept it. See, it wasn't God who wanted to kill Paul. It was the Jews who are planning to kill Paul, because they're really angry at him right now. And God is just simply saying, listen, when you go, the Jews are going to kill you. Why? Because the Jews also have their free will to choose whatever they wanted to. And God, knowing what they wanted, is just telling Paul that's what's going to happen. But it was Paul who accepted this, you know, future, you know, this chance. And because he was ready to die, he was ready to die. So once again, when God shows us some sort of vision or foreknowledge or prophecy, it doesn't necessarily mean that that is set in stone. Okay, people still have chance to make the right choices. One of good examples in the Old Testament. So God tells, you know, the prophet Jonah. Remember Jonah? So God goes to Jonah and says, go and tell the people of Nineveh that if they do not repent and change their ways, destruction will come to them. So God is giving them a foreknowledge of their fate, okay? Because they are so evil. So Jonah, of course, did not want to go and tell them and warn them, because see, Jonah didn't like the people of Nineveh. He said, oh, they deserve to die. So he was running away on a ship opposite to Nineveh. And of course, the big fish comes and swallows them up. And we know the story. So what does Jonah do? He actually ends up going to Nineveh. And then he says, okay, fine, God, I'll give them that message. It says, oh, repent, O people of Nineveh, because if you don't, you're all going to die. So what did the people of Nineveh do? Did they say, oh, wow, like God is giving us foreknowledge that we're all going to die, too bad, too late, let's all just die? No, that's not what they did. They repented, right? They put ashes on their heads and they were wearing sackcloth and they're praying, kneeling, crying, asking for forgiveness. Guess what happened to the people in Nineveh? Did the destruction come to them? Oh, of course not. Of course not. God spared them, right? So remember that even when we hear things like God foretold someone, God prophesizes some kind of fate, it doesn't mean that there's no chance to change it. No, we always have a chance to change it by repenting, by praying, by asking for forgiveness, and things like that. So don't ever think that we are in this kind of fatalistic kind of mindset. I know some people say everything is decided already, it's predetermined, it's predestined. No matter what you do, it doesn't matter. Either you're gonna go to heaven or go to hell, depending on what God wanted to do for you. This is very Calvinistic, very Protestant idea and understanding, which is very, very non-Catholic. And I would say wrong. That's a wrong way of looking at this. No, as Catholics, we were taught, yes, we all have a destiny. Okay, what's our destiny? Our destiny is to go to heaven and to live forever with God and everybody around. See, that is our destiny. However, it was not predetermined. Okay, it is not set in stone. We could cooperate with God by accepting his salvation and following the teachings of Jesus and then being saved, or we can reject it. We can reject it. And that is why we always have to be on guard that we're not rejecting God's, you know, teachings and God's invitation, but accepting God's invitation and following the path that Jesus has taught us and shown us. See, that is the thing. That is what we need to remember. We always have a choice. Same thing. Paul had a choice. He could have run away. He could have run away, but he says, no, I'm not afraid of the Jews. I'm not afraid of dying. I'm going to go and be a witness of God's graciousness and God's power, you know, in saving the Gentiles, inviting Gentiles to Christianity. Okay, so he is going to go there to defend that, to defend that. He's not going to go there to die. Like, that's not what he wants. Paul's not going to say, oh, I want to go and die. No, that's what he's saying. He's saying, but I'm going to go to Jerusalem. I'm going to show them that God wants Gentiles to be saved. God wants Gentiles to be part of God's salvation. Because the Jews were saying only Jews can be saved and all Gentiles should go into hell and you know, eternally suffer. See, that's their mentality, right? Only Jews can be saved. That's what, only Jews can be saved. Only Jews. If you want to be saved, be circumcised, become a Jew. Only Jew can be saved. And Paul's like, no, Gentiles can be saved, even though they don't become a Jew. Even though they don't become circumcised, they still can be saved. This is God's will. This is the teaching of Jesus Christ. Well, these Jews, they want to kill him for that. And Paul is saying, listen, I will die to defend that. I will die to proclaim that. So it's not about going there to die. As Jesus did not want to go and just die. You know, that's not his point. Jesus was trying to tell them, I am the Son of God. And the Jewish leader said, no, you're not. You're a blasphemer. You're just a carpenter's son. You're some kid who don't even have a father. Because they knew that Joseph was not his real father, right? So you're just a bastard, if you could use that word, right? Fatherless child, bastard. So they want to kill him, and that's what they do. Jesus did not want to go and die, but he's going to go and say, I'm not going to be afraid to tell you, I am the Son of God. I am God. I am the Lord of the Sabbath. You know, and that infuriated the Jewish leaders, and Jesus is killed. Right? So it's not about dying. It's about defending the faith, defending the teachings of God, defending the teachings of Jesus, defending, you know, what God has given to us, you know, because we want to defend that. And unfortunately, sometimes, yes, we have to shed our blood for that, you know, but the intention is not to die. So this is not a suicide, okay? It was only natural for them to try to dissuade him from going, of course, right? Like, who wants somebody to die, right? Like, so everybody is like, Paul, you can't go. Like, don't go to Jerusalem. You're going to go, you're going to die, right? It's a sign of Christian fraternity and mutual affection, right? Without losing our serenity, we too should be concerned about our brothers and sisters' physical and spiritual health, okay? I know sometimes we think, oh, I'm nobody's keeper, you know. That's what Cain said. Remember Cain? He killed Abel, and God asks Cain, Cain, where's your brother? Where's Abel? And Cain says, am I my brother's keeper? He says, right? And the answer to that, of course, yes, you are your brother's keeper. We are our brothers and sisters' keeper. We have to take care of each other. We're all brothers and sisters in the Lord, and we need to help each other, take care of each other, spiritually and physically, not just spiritually, okay? St. James in the letter told us clearly, what good is it if we tell a brother on the street, naked and hungry, and say, may God bless you, brother? No, he said, no, go and feed him, clothe him, shelter him, and then say, may God bless you, okay? So it's very important that we take care of each other, both physical and spiritual health. Saint Jose Maria Escriva says, I am glad that you feel concerned for your brothers. There is no better proof of your mutual love. Take care, however, that your concern does not degenerate into anxiety. So Saint Jose Maria Escriva is warning us, because sometimes when we get too concerned and over concerned, it can become into anxiety and fear and trembling, and that's not healthy either. That's not healthy either. See, trying to help our brothers and sisters is one thing, but always constantly nagging at them, criticizing them, and bothering them, that's not helping them either. That's not helping them either. So we need to have the right kind of balance, okay? Verse 5, kneeling down on the beach, we prayed. It's beautiful. Can you imagine? They're on this beach on the ocean. Paul and the other disciples are there, like Luke and Timothy. And then like all these people, men, women, children from the community, basically in our sense, like our parish, they're saying farewell to Paul, you know, before he's going on the ship. And they're all just kneeling there together, kneeling and praying. Beautiful, right? Beautiful. Every place is suitable for raising one's heart to God and speaking to him. There's no place where it is not unworthy to pray to God, okay? So don't fall into this trap that saying, well, I should only pray in the church. No, you could pray anywhere. You could pray while you're on the bus or you're on the train, while you're driving, anywhere you could pray. But at the same time, you should always come to church and pray also, right? So this is not this or that. This is this and that, okay? So we pray at the church, we pray in our homes, but also means that we could pray in anywhere is possible, okay? Because it's always important that we pray and converse with God daily, all the time, okay? Very important. Once again, St. Jose Maria Escriva writes, each day without fail, we should devote some time, especially to God, raising our minds to him without any need for the words to come to our lips, for they are being sung in our heart. Let us give enough time to this devout practice at a fixed hour, if possible, before the tabernacle, close to him who has reminded there out of love. If this is not possible, we can pray anywhere, because our God is ineffably present in the heart of every soul in grace. Isn't it wonderful that, see, our God is so good that he provides us a very specific place where we know, guaranteed, that we will find his presence in the real presence of Jesus's Eucharist, right? His body, blood, soul, and divinity. And, you know, it's not just Jesus's, you know, presence there, but it's God's presence, because Jesus, Father, Son, they're one God, right? They're not separate people. They're separate divine people, but they're not separate God. They're one God. So meaning in the Eucharist, we find the presence of the Holy Trinity. So when we come to church and we're sitting or standing in front of a tabernacle, our God is there. The Trinity is there, okay? So Isn't it so wonderful that God is providing us a guaranteed place of his presence? Okay, the Trinity's presence, God's presence. Okay, so we should make that effort to try to spend time in front of the tabernacle. Absolutely. However, when it is not possible, isn't it wonderful that God will give us another sense of presence, his own presence through our hearts? That's where he resides. We are the temples of the Holy Spirit, St. Paul teaches us, right? So isn't it wonderful that we have both? So right now, currently, we're on a very strict lockdown. We can't come to church. It's tearing us apart. But we need to remember, that God is present in our hearts, in our souls. And continually, actively, pray the spiritual communion, receive communion spiritually. Very important, everyone, very important. God will give us the graces we need through spiritual communion, and he will be present to us. Of course, it's not the same as physical communion. It's not as good as, you know, physical communion in some aspects. Of course, we need that physical contact. But meanwhile, okay, until we are back to normal, we just have to persevere through this and continue to do this, okay? Don't forget that God provides us all the time. We're not disconnected. Unless we waver in faith and say, oh, church is closed. You know, all these bishops are, you know, check-ins are afraid to fight the government. We have to fight the government and protect our faith. And very dangerous way of thinking. Very dangerous, because we're not at war with the government. We're at war with viruses right now, COVID viruses. That's what we're at war with. And you know, many people right now are in intensive care and they're dying. People are dying because of this virus. And now they're saying a lot of young people are dying because of the variant version is very aggressive. Right? So we're fighting viruses. We're not fighting government. We're not fighting public health. We're definitely fighting with our bishops, okay? Like, no, step out of that. Like, if you know anybody who's thinking like that, like, distance yourself from them because they're not in the right mind. They're not in the right mind, okay? We have to remember we're fighting viruses, okay? But stay connected. Do spiritual communion. Some people might say, oh, I don't care about spiritual communion. I want physical communion and that's it. Wow. So they're going to reject spiritual communion? Because some people think like that, unfortunately. They say, if it's not physical communion, I want no communion at all. Wow. That's rejecting God. You're rejecting God by doing that. No, you have to open yourself up and receive God's graces. Okay? Verse 8. So we're talking about Philip. So who is this Philip? Now, many times, many people in history got confused between this Philip and Apostle Philip, okay? But this is not the Apostle Philip. He's actually the one of the seven deacons that was made into deacon along with Stephen, the first martyr, remember? So this is one of the seven deacons who was ordained to help the needy in Jerusalem. We find it in Acts chapter 6, verse 5. And he also played an important part in evangelization of Samaria, chapter 8, and opposed Simon the magician, same chapter 8. And he baptized the Ethiopian courtier, chapter 8 also, okay? So this is Philip the deacon, or Philip the evangelist, okay? Different Philip than Philip the apostles, okay? And it's interesting because we believe that because of this Ethiopian courtier who was converted, that is the beginning of the Ethiopian Christian community or Ethiopian Catholic Church, which most of them have unfortunately became Orthodox because they did not want to accept Pope in Rome as their head of the church. So it's sad story, but there's still our apostolic sister churches, okay? So just kind of, give you a little bit of explanation is that for accurate terminology, the term church in the Christianity should only be applied to two churches only. First is the Catholic Church, and second is the Orthodox Church. Because all the others, denominations like Protestants, Anglicans, United, they're not really churches, they're communities. I know they call themselves church, but to us, our understanding of what church is, you know, it has to be one holy Catholic and apostolic. And Orthodox, they have that, okay? Although, you know, there's still a little bit of division between us and them, but that division is a lot to do with politics, okay? Because of who is the hierarchical, you know, head of the church. For example, Catholics, we believe that's the Pope. The Orthodox believe that it's their own bishops or patriarchs. So it's more of a political kind of divide than theological or spiritual or doctrine-wise. So we could still argue that Orthodox and Catholic are still one. It's holy because of the Holy Spirit. Catholic means universal, right? Not that they're Roman Catholics or not, they're universal, and they're apostolic, right? Orthodox, they're apostolic, because the Apostle John and other apostles, you know, established their community, right? The Paul, John, and all the early apostles, right? Peter. So we have to really, really say that the only per se churches that contain those four marks of the church are Catholic churches and Orthodox churches. All the others, they lack something. Either they lack apostolic or they lack the oneness. So they're not really churches, they're kind of communities. So the terminology is accurately saying that there are Christian communities. There are only two churches that has all those four marks. Once again, that's Catholics and Orthodox. They have valid priesthood, valid sacraments. So we call the Orthodox our sister church, okay? Just a side explanation. Verse 9, and this deacon Philip had four daughters who were unmarried. Virginity is a gift of God, which Paul discusses in his letters, 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 25 to 40. Let's see what he says. It's long, but let's just go over it. Now, concerning virgins, I have no command of the Lord, but I give my opinion as one who, by the Lord's mercy, is trustworthy. I think that in view of the impending crisis, it is well for you to remain as you are. Are you bound to a wife? Do not seek to be free. Are you free from a wife? Do not seek a wife. But if you marry, you do not sin. And if a virgin marries, she does not sin. Yet those who marry will experience distress in this life, and I will spare you that. I mean, brothers and sisters, the appointed time has grown short. From now on, let even those who have wives be as though they had none, and those who mourn as though they were not mourning, and those who rejoice as though they were not rejoicing, and those who buy as though they had no possessions, and those who deal with the world as though they had no dealings with it. For the present form of this world is passing away. I want you to be free from anxieties. The unmarried man is anxious about the affairs of the Lord, how to please the Lord, but the married man is anxious about the affairs of the world, how to please his wife, and his interests are divided. And the unmarried woman and the virgin are anxious about the affairs of the Lord, so that they may be holy in body and spirit, but the married woman is anxious about the affairs of the world, how to please her husband. I say this for your own benefit, not to put any restraint upon you, but to promote good order and unhindered devotion to the Lord. If anyone thinks that he is not behaving properly toward his fiancée, if his passions are strong, and so it has to be, let him marry as he wishes. It is no sin. Let them marry. But if someone stands firm in his resolve, being under no necessity, but having his own desire under control, and has determined in his own mind to keep her as his fiancée, he will do well. So then, he who marries his fiancée does well. And he who refrains from marriage will do better. A wife is bound as long as her husband lives, but if the husband dies, she is free to marry anyone she wishes, only in the Lord. But in my judgment, she is more blessed if she remains as she is. and I think that I too have the Spirit of God. Very long. First thing that I have to say is that we need to be careful how we interpret this, okay? Once again, he wrote this in a very specific time, specific circumstances. What is he really trying to say? First, he's not saying that marriage is bad, okay? No, that's not what he's saying. He's saying marriage is good. But he's saying, if you can keep single, like keep virginity, like don't marry, because that can be better. And the reason why it can be better is because then you will be more concerned about God and godly things. That's why it is better. Not because marriage is bad, but because if you're single or if you're celibate, then you could be more concerned of God and heaven and all these things, which is more beneficial. However, he's saying that all this in the context of this present circumstances that he's in, where there is brewing of persecution. So when you're persecuted, we're talking about being kicked out of your home, being kicked out of your town, being kicked out of your country. You may have to migrate to different locations. Okay. You may even have to die, imprisoned, tortured. So in front of persecution, I think it's very logical that Paul would be saying, hey, listen, if you're not married, like, don't. Maybe it's better to stay single right now because persecution is coming. They're going to come after us, you know? See, those are some of the things that we must understand. So Paul is not saying that people shouldn't get married. No, that's not what he's saying. But in that context, Paul is saying it is better to be celibate if we are going to serve the Lord more freely. And that is why the Roman Catholic Church has decided, the Roman Catholic Church, meaning within the Catholic Church, there is Roman Rite and Eastern Rite, remember? So Roman Rite is us, you know, we get our tradition from Rome. There are also Greek Catholics, Ethiopian Catholics, Coptic Catholics, you know, different Eastern rites, right? But see, most of the Eastern Catholic rites, just like the Orthodox, they do have married priests, you know? They do have priests who are already married. Priests don't marry, but married men become priests, right? But in the Latin or the Roman rite, or also called the Western rite, we don't have married priests or priests who marry. Occasionally, when an Anglican priest joins the Catholic Church and becomes ordained again, then he can keep his wife. Like, you don't tell him to divorce his wife to become a Catholic priest, right? Because they're already been living as a... See, Anglican ordination is really not valid, but because of that history and that closeness with the Catholic Church, the church sometimes allows an Anglican priest to join the Catholic Church and become a Catholic ordained priest. But once again, he is allowed to keep his wife, right? But if that wife dies, okay, he cannot get remarried. Once a priest, you cannot get remarried. Even permanent deacons, we allow married men to become permanent deacons, right? But if the wife passes away, they cannot remarry, okay? So once you become a clergy, ordained clergy in the church, you cannot marry. Okay, so here, the Roman Church took St. Paul's, you know, teaching very seriously, and they also realized that as a clergy, it is better to be celibate, unmarried, because otherwise the priest has to worry about his wife and his children. I don't know if I told you this story, probably I did. When I was in university, in my final years, I had a female friend who I was chatting with, and one day, and she said, so John, like, what's your plans? What are you going to do after graduation? So I said, I'm probably going to go to the seminary. And she got so upset, she grabbed me by the collar, and she said, no, you will not. You will not go to the seminary. And I was really taken aback because I didn't know what she was trying to say. And then the next words shocked me more when she said, my dad is a priest and I hate it. your dad is a priest. So I just listened to what she had to say. And then she went and said, my dad is an Anglican priest. And all my life, he was never home. He neglected my mom and me. And we were always under scrutiny of the community. And I hate it. I hate it. And you should not become a priest. So I looked at her and I said, by the way, I'm Catholic. We don't get married. Then she kind of got embarrassed a little bit. So she kind of let my collar go and said, oh, in that case, you can go. So we had a chat about that. And I realized listening to her story, how difficult it was for her mom and for her, because yes, her father was always at the parish, always taking care of the parishioners, but he was never home. Now, is this a universal experience? Probably not. Maybe this is more individual specific circumstances, but I do understand how difficult it would have been for priests to be married, because I will be divided too. I will be divided too, like between my family and my parish family. Oh man, it's gonna be hard. It's not gonna be easy. It's not impossible to do, because the Eastern Rite and the Orthodox have been doing it all for 2,000 years. So it's not like it's impossible, but I'm telling you, it's not easy either. So what St. Paul is saying is realistic. You know, if you really want to dedicate your life to the service of God in the community, it is better to be single. That's why we have religious who are celibates or single. We have clergy who is celibate and single. And another thing is that if Roman Catholic priests are married, can you imagine if Monsignor Vid and we both had wives and children? You guys have to give church probably 5 times more financially that you're already giving, because see, we have to feed our family, we have to put our kids to school and clothe them, educate them, and buy them cars, and we're not going to be able to do that with our allowance that we receive, you know. So yeah, sorry, I mean, the church is not a business, we don't sell anything, so it all has to come from donation of the people. So you guys, whatever you're giving now, multiply that at least 3 times to 5 times, and then we can have married priests. And I think most people say, no thank you Father, we want you to stay single. Yes, I think so too, right? So it's good for our church. It's good for our church. It's difficult. Celibacy is difficult. Being single is difficult. But there is wisdom and there is the guidance of the Holy Spirit. And there's a reason why we have celibate priests. And I see the value of it. I really do. I really do see the value of it. Okay, so let us not misunderstand what Paul is trying to say. He's not saying don't get married. No, like, we should get married, we should have children, yes, we should take care of each other, grow family, but in terms of, you know, serving the church, serving God, yes, celibacy is better for that purpose. And I think that's what Paul is trying to say, okay? JP2 also says in his apostolic exhortation on the family, he devotes a section to this form of self-dedication to God. And he says, virginity or celibacy for the sake of the kingdom of God not only does not contradict the dignity of marriage, but presupposes it and confirms it. Marriage and virginity or celibacy are two ways of expressing and living the one mystery of the covenant of God with his people. Virginity or celibacy, by liberating the human heart in a unique way, bears witness that the kingdom of God and his justice is that pearl of great price, which is preferred to every other value, no matter how great, and hence must be sought as the only definitive value. It is for this reason that the church throughout her history has always defended the superiority of this charism to that of marriage by reason of the holy singular link which is has with the kingdom of God. In spite of having renounced physical fecundity, the celibate person becomes spiritually fruitful, the father and mother of many, cooperating in the realization of the family according to God's plan. So once again, also JP2, in the context of serving the church and serving the people of God, celibacy or virginity is superior. It is superior because we are freed from this exclusiveness, okay? However, it's important to understand that, see, it is both celibacy and marriage. It's all about love. It's all about love. It's just a different way of expressing it. See, marriage, you're being exclusive. Basically saying, I'm only going to love you and no one else. Okay? So when a guy marries a girl marries a guy, you're saying, I'm rejecting everybody else in the world. Okay? It becomes very exclusive. On the other hand, celibacy is basically saying the opposite. I'm going to make it inclusive, meaning I'm going to love everybody. Okay? I'm going to love everybody, including everybody. Okay? See, that is different, but it's all about love and how to love. It's a little bit different, but it's, one is inclusive, meaning I'm going to love everybody. The other one, exclusive, I'm just going to love you and reject others. And when I say love, it doesn't mean that, you know, married people don't love other people, but in that very kind of, you know, intimate way, right? Intimate, you know, love is between spouses only, right? And children too, but to look at it this way, it's like there was one day an orphanage, and there came a nun, a sister nun, and she was, you know, teaching the orphanage class for the first time. And this was the first time these orphans saw this nun. They never saw a nun before. So, you know, after her lesson, she said, okay, children, does anybody have questions? And one little child raised her hand, you know, and then said, do you have children? Like, do you have your own children? And then the sister said, oh, no, no, no. I'm not married. I'm a nun. I dedicate myself to God and his people. I don't have children of my own. And then as soon as she said that, all the children raised their hands and cheered, yay! And they said, then you can be our mother. And I think that is exactly what celibacy is supposed to be. It's not that celibacy is saying, I'm not going to love anybody. No, celibacy is opposite. Celibacy is saying, I'm going to love everybody. Okay, so that is a little bit different approach, different way of expressing. But marriage, celibacy, they're both about love. They're both about loving someone, okay? So very important for us to have that kind of understanding. The prophet Agabus, okay, from verse 10 to 11. So Agabus was the Christian prophet who years earlier warned of forthcoming of famine and privation, Acts 11, verses 27, 28. At that time, prophets came down from Jerusalem to Antioch. One of them named Agabus stood up and predicted by the Spirit that there would be a severe famine over all the world. And this took place during the reign of Claudius. Okay. In his present prophecy, okay, so he came and does prophecy again. He uses symbolic gestures like Old Testament prophets, particularly Jeremiah. And his action is somewhat reminiscent of our Lord's prophecy about St. Peter in John 21, 18. So red is Jesus saying, truly, truly, I say to you, when you were young, you girded yourself and walked where you would. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and another will gird you and carry you where you do not wish to go. So this was a kind of warning of how St. Peter would be dragged to Rome and become, you know, crucified, right? And it's kind of similar. St. Paul is receiving the same kind of prophecy that he's going to be bound by rope, he's going to be dragged, okay? Now going back to Agabus, he is actually one of the 70 disciples, okay? And it is said that he was present at the Pentecost with the apostles at the upper room. Later, he is martyred in Antioch and his feast day is February 13th. Okay, so give you a little background. Verses 12 and 14, the Spirit's words and warnings confirm Paul's readiness to accept the will of God and bear the trials which they foretell. Now, this warning was not specific to Paul because Jesus warned all disciples, every disciples of him, all Christians, that, listen, if they persecuted me and killed me, don't think that they're going to treat you any better. Remember, Jesus said, like, they will also drag you into courts and persecute you and even kill you. See, Jesus said, no servant is better than the master. Remember, like, he told us clearly, as disciples of Jesus, as Christians, all of us are bound to, you know, be persecuted in some way or another. So this should not come as a surprise to us. It should not. If it was a surprise, I'm sorry to give you the bad news, but we all will receive persecution. But this persecution does not always mean bloody persecution. It could just mean things like being ridiculed by your friends, being ridiculed by your children, being ridiculed by your family members or your friends because of your faith in Jesus Christ. That is also persecution, right? So we need to be strong. Don't be surprised by it. Accept it. It's normal. It's actually the path that we should be on. Some people actually say, if you're not persecuted, if you don't feel persecution, you know what that means? That means that you're not really truly a Christian. Okay? You're doing something wrong. If you're doing something right, you should be persecuted. Okay, that's kind of one way of looking at it. But at the same time, that doesn't mean that you should go in and you know, instigate all these people, you know, bothering them and you know, enticing them to persecute you, because that's not being persecuted for your faith. That's, you're just being a mean person. That's why people hate you, okay? So don't pick on people, okay? That's not persecution, that's just retaliation, okay? His serenity contrasts with the concern felt by those around him, which stems from their affection for him. His long life for self-surrender and self-forgetfulness explains why he takes things so calmly at this time. St. Teresa comments, this consists mainly or entirely in our ceasing to care about ourselves and our own pleasures, but the least that anyone who is beginning to serve the Lord can truly offer him in his life. Once he has surrendered his will to him, what has he to fear? St. Jose Maria Escriva says, accepting the will of God wholeheartedly is a sure way of finding joy and peace. Happiness is in the cross. Then we realize that Christ's yoke is sweet and that his burden is not heavy. So basically what they're saying is that, see, Paul was not basically just saying like, oh, you know what, I want to suffer. I want to die. Please bring it on. Like, oh God, give me suffering. No, that's not his mindset. What he's saying is, look, all I care about is pleasing the Lord. All I care about doing the right thing. All I care about is defending the faith. All I care about are the people of the Christian churches, you know, I found it on different cities. I'm just wholly concerned about the church, and that's it. And if something bad happens to me, so be it. But I care about God and the church. That's what I'm caring about. And that is what Paul is saying, okay? Being totally concerned about God and the church, not about himself, okay? Paul's example impresses the disciples and moves them to accept what God has disposed in words reminiscent of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, right? When he says, I'll accept your will, God. You know, Father, I accept your will. And same thing, Paul's saying, I'm going to accept God's will. I'm going to accept God's will. Okay. Before we go on to next chapter, any questions so far? Okay, let's continue verse 17 onwards. When we arrived in Jerusalem, the brothers welcomed us warmly. The next day, Paul went with us to visit James, and all the elders were present. After greeting them, he related one by one the things that God had done among the Gentiles through his ministry. When they heard it, they praised God. Then they said to him, "You see, brother, how many thousands of believers there are among the Jews, and they all are zealous for the law. They have been told about you that you teach all the Jews living among the Gentiles to forsake Moses, and that you tell them not to circumcise their children or observe the customs. What then is to be done? They will certainly hear that you have come. So do what we tell you. We have four men who are under a vow. Join these men, go through the rite of purification with them, and pay for the shaving of their heads. Thus all will know that there is nothing in what they have been told about you, but that you yourself observe and guard the law. But as for the Gentiles who have become believers, we have sent the letter with our judgment that they should abstain from what has been sacrificed to idols and from blood and from what is strangled and from fornication." Then Paul took the men, and the next day, having purified himself, he entered the temple with them, making public the completion of the days of purification when the sacrifice would be made for each of them. So Paul arrives in Jerusalem and meets other Christians, and he goes, meets James the Less, okay? St. James the Less, St. James the Great has already been martyred, right? Now St. James the Less, who happened to be Jesus's cousin, is now in charge of Jerusalem. And I think it's because most of the other apostles are outside of Jerusalem, spreading the gospel elsewhere. Peter is no longer there either, right? So, and it's also the elders. Remember, elders were like parish priests in today's term. They're not bishops, they're not apostles, but they're elders who help the apostles or the bishop to run the community, the churches, right? So, so James and the elders meets Paul and his companions. St. Luke usually distinguishes elders from apostles. Apparently the apostles, including Peter, were no longer residing in the city. The narrative here ceases to use a first person plural and does not use it again until the account of the journey to Rome later in Acts 27. This indicates that Luke accompanied Paul as far as Jerusalem and then was with them from Caesarea to Rome. Verse 19, Paul's apostolic ministry among the Gentiles readily accepted by the Christians of the Mother Church of Jerusalem because God has demonstrated his legitimacy by blessing it with great fruitfulness. God guides and plans a mission to the Gentiles. Paul, in fact, attributes all his success to the Lord. 1 Corinthians 3:7, he says, "Neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth." This conviction has guided every step he has taken. Origen writes, "Everyone who prudently and intelligently looks at the history of the apostles of Jesus will clearly see that they preached Christianity with God-given strength and thereby were able to attract men to the word of God." Verse 20, they're talking about there are zealous Jews, okay? So St. James saying, "Look, listen, Paul, as you know, there are thousands of Jews here, Jewish Christians who are zealous, okay? Not jealous, but zealous. They're full of, you know, enthusiasm, full of energy, full of, you know, and, you know, focus. You know, they're very, very motivated, right? But they're not the same with the people that called a group called zealots, okay, zealots, okay? These zealots, for example, Apostle Simon was one of the zealots, right? They are actually people, Jewish, who are fighting against Roman occupation. Ardent attachment to the traditions of the fathers and hatred of the Romans had led to the development of a sect of zealots, men of violence who played a key role in the rebellion of 66. Of course, this rebellion, okay, the anti-Roman revolt described by detail by Flavius Josephus in his book, The Jewish War, ended with the total destruction of the temple and of Jerusalem by the armies of Vespasian and Titus, right? So the zealots were these group of people. Now, the zealous Jews, St. James is talking about, is not them. They're talking about the Jewish Christians who are also very traditional. They want to keep their Jewish tradition in Christianity. We talked about that before, right? And there were rumors, okay, that Paul was doing, which was very, very wrong in their eyes, and you know, it was really making them angry. Because they were saying, the rumors were saying that the apostle regarded Mosaic law something secondary, okay, as far as salvation is concerned, and he did not accept circumcision as absolutely necessary, okay? But of course, we know this accusation is unjust. See, Paul's mind is that if you're a Gentile, then you don't need to be circumcised. Okay? He didn't say that all Christians, including the Jews, should not be circumcised. No, he was talking about only Gentiles, non-Jews, okay? See, Paul never exhorted Christians of Jewish background not to circumcise their sons, and himself ensured that Timothy was circumcised. Remember, Timothy was circumcised also? Why? Because Timothy had both parents who were Jews, right? Who were Jews. Titus, on the other hand, was from Gentile family, so that's why Paul did not circumcise Titus, but he circumcised Timothy before he became baptized Christian. I hope you remember that, right? So in Corinth, he came out in support of women following the Jewish customs of wearing the veil in liturgical ceremonies, and he himself had no difficulty about taking a Nazarite vow. We assume that it was him who took the Nazarite vow. St. Bede says, Paul was calumniated by those who did not understand the spirit with which these customs should be kept by Jewish Christians, that is, in a spirit of homage to the divine authority and a prophetic holiness of these signs, and not in order to attain salvation, which had been revealed with Christ and applied through the sacrament of baptism. Those who calumniated were people who wanted to observe these customs as if believers in the gospel could not attain salvation without them. So basically, we have to remember, it was a Council of Jerusalem, okay? The first ecumenical council of the Catholic Church proclaimed that Gentiles don't need to be circumcised, period. But there were Jewish Christians within the church who did not accept the teachings of the first Jerusalem council. And this will repeat on and on and on throughout the history of the church. After councils of councils, when church defines and teaches certain doctrine or dogma, there are always groups of people within the church who reject it, who don't accept it, and they want to do their own thing because they say that was a tradition. It happens now too. Vatican II clearly taught many things, but there are a group of people who said, no, we don't want to accept Vatican II. Every pope after Vatican II is anti-pope. They're not real popes. So they've gone from our church, created their own churches or communities, I should say, right? Ecclesial community, not church, but ecclesial community, saying that they are the true Catholics. So that's what we have this denomination called Old Catholics, or, you know, all these other groups who say, argue that everything that happened after Vatican II is all wrong and it's un-Catholic, un-Christian, all anti-popes, and everybody's going to go to hell. Okay, sure. But you know what? Nothing new. Nothing new. It has been happening since the beginning of the church's time, even in times of Jesus' time, even at the apostles' time. Nothing new. What we remember have to do is we have to keep faithful to the teachings that was given to us by the popes and the councils of the church that clearly define what is a teaching of the church. Okay, we got to accept that. Especially the universal councils, you know, the ecumenical councils like Vatican II and things like that. Okay, there's also like teachings of specific to certain local councils. Those are not universal teaching. Those are not universal teaching. It does not apply to the Catholics in the world. Only ecumenical councils and those other teachings defined by the Pope and the Magisterium is universal, okay? The Nazarite vow they're talking about is the one who committed himself to abstaining from certain kinds of food and drink, not cutting their hair during the period of the vow, okay? And another one was to not be in presence of a dead body. Okay, so even if your parents dies, you cannot go to the funeral. Okay, and Samson, remember Samson in the Old Testament, he was the Nazarite, right? He didn't cut his hair, but when Delilah cut his hair, he lost his powers. So after his hair grew, he gained his power back. Remember that story? Yeah. So to end the vow, the person arranged a sacrificial offering in the temple. So St. James suggests that Paul should go with these people, pay for their sacrifice, right? Meaning that showing people, hey, I'm still a Jew. I keep all the laws. I'm not against the Jewish traditions. It's kind of like a way of showing people that he, Paul, is still in respect of the law in the temple. Paul is putting into practice here the advice he's given to Christian Corinth. To the Jews, I became a Jew in order to win Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though not being myself under the law, that I might win those under the law. Paul is not saying that he has a double standard. That's not what he's saying. But he understands that there's a value for Jews to continue their Jewish tradition because see, Jewish tradition is still valid. Now, I know there are some Christians who say like all Jews are going to go to hell. No, like that does not work that way because see, God has a covenant with the Jews. Yes, it was before Jesus' time, but see, Jesus did not come to cancel the old covenant. He came to perfect it, okay? So the Jews still are under the old covenant. I mean, to us it's old, but for them, that's the only covenant that they have. But it's still valid because see, God does not cancel his promise. God never cancels his covenant. It is still valid. So can Jews still be saved? Why not? God has covenant with them, but God will be judged, right? God will judge them accordingly. But for us who receive Jesus Christ, the new covenant, we will be judged under the new covenant, okay? So instead of worrying about what the Jews are doing, we have to be worried about what we're doing. Are we faithful to our covenant? And Paul recognized this early on. He said, the Jews have their own covenants, their own traditions, and we need to keep that and respect that. See, when we study the book of Romans, it comes up more clearly of this theology that the Jewish people are still chosen people of God. They're still under covenant of God, and they're still, you know, under guidance and protection of God. It does that. You cannot take that away from them. But for us Christians, Paul is saying, but us Christians who are Gentile, non-Jews, we don't have to take upon all the traditions and teachings that the Jews receive because it doesn't apply to us. It's different. See, the new covenant does not demand that. What the new covenant demands is not circumcision of the body, but circumcision of the mind, circumcision of the soul. And what the circumcision means just basically means I belong to God. I belong to God. I accept God as my God, and I'm his people. That's what basically baptism does for us. We circumcise our souls and say, I belong to God. Okay, and we need to keep that in mind. Am I circumcised in the spirit, in the soul? You know, do I really believe that I belong to God? Do I really believe that my life belongs to God? Do I really believe that everything that I possess actually belongs to God? Because if we don't believe that, we might be baptized, but we're not circumcised in the heart. And Paul is saying, we Christians, we need to be circumcised in the heart, in the soul, okay? Verse 25, St. James quotes the decisions of the Council of Jerusalem, which Paul, of course, was very familiar. He was present at the first Jewish Jerusalem Council, and he was one of those, you know, assisting and carrying those messages to the communities. Presumably does this for the benefit of the apostles' companions who are not required naturally to go with Paul to the temple, okay? So we'll stop here. I think we did go a little bit over time, but now we're in Jerusalem, so we're going to see what happens to Paul in the temple. Okay, that's what's going to come up next time. Okay. Any questions, comments?
go ahead.
I guess not, then let's conclude with a prayer in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray for the intentions of our Holy Father and our Bishop. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as he was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Lord be with you. The Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in the peace of Christ. Thank you very much, everyone. Thanks for joining us. Hope to see you soon.